The Quran.
The Quran, okay. Yes.
History
of who though? Because you learn history in the other school as well, right?
Yeah.
So whose history do we learn over here? Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Always when you say the Prophet's name, you say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yes. You had a point?
I was going to say that.
The same thing. Okay. What about the Ahlul Bayt? Do we learn about the Ahlul Bayt here?
Yeah.
Yeah. So we know who is Imam Hussain. We know who's Imam Ali. We know who's Fatima Zahra alayhi salam Allah. Okay. So why is that important for us to come to this school? Because in the other school, they teach us science, which we can use at work. They teach us maths, which we can use at work, right? They teach us history, which we can make money from, right? So they teach us skills that make us money in this world, in that school. But what about here? Can we, you know, can I go to, say, a bank tomorrow and say, give me a job because I know who's Rasulullah?
No.
They wouldn't give you a job, right? So why is it important also? So what do we benefit from this particular school that we don't benefit from the other schools? Think about it. You learn what's halal and haram, okay? So every time you're learning the Quran teaches you what's halal and what's haram. Every time you learn about Rasulullah, you learn examples about what Rasulullah did was halal, and what he stopped people from doing is haram. This is what we call amr bil ma'ruf and nahi anil munkar, okay? To enjoin good and to forbid evil, okay? Let's say you go to school and you become a scientist, and then you discover nuclear power, okay? Let's say the first person who discovered nuclear power, if that person knew who Rasulullah is, and he knew who Imam Hussein is, and he knew who Imam Ali is, and he knew who Fatima Zahra was, would he have ever dropped a nuclear bomb on another country and killed millions of people?
No.
No, right? Okay. The person, the companies that make guns, okay? Would they give those guns to people who can go out and rob banks and kill people if they knew Allah and the Ahlul Bayt?
No.
No. Okay. So the reason why we come here to learn, it's what we call moral compass. Okay. Moral compass, according to the school of the Ahlul Bayt, means it doesn't teach you what science is. It teaches you what to do with science. Okay. So we all know that 1 + 1 = 2. Okay. But now, what do I do with 1 + 1 = 2 in a good way, and how do I not use that lesson in a bad way? Okay, and that's why it's very important for us to come here to learn about the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam Allah. So, for example, if we were tomorrow, today banks, okay, the banking system, if you can't afford your mortgage, they take your home from you, and then you and your family become homeless. Okay, is that good or bad?
Bad,
right? So maybe we need someone who knows who the Ahlul Bayt are to study banking, and then come up with a new banking system that doesn't put people out of their houses, that actually helps people, it has kindness within it, okay? Maybe we can have someone who's in government tomorrow that says not everyone can have a gun, okay? Because human lives are lost, okay? Maybe we can have someone who becomes in politics, but because they know about the Ahlul Bayt, they will stop invading other countries, and instead they start to have open dialogue, they start to have peaceful dialogue, okay? So that's the reason why we come here to learn about the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam Allah, because they help us to use that knowledge which we attain in the school. They help us how to use that knowledge in a right way. Why is that important? Because there's a life after this life, yes? There's heaven and there's hell, yes? How many of us believe there's heaven and hell? Okay, will I go to heaven if I kill people?
No.
Will I go to heaven if I put people out of their homes?
No.
Will I go to heaven if I cheat people?
No.
So then it's important for us to come here and also learn how to use the knowledge in the dunya to get me into Jannah in the Akhirah. Okay? Let me give you an example of Salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Salawat ala Nabi.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Okay. Let's say, for example, who has a PlayStation? Who has a PlayStation 4? PS4. Who else has like an Xbox or any other games? So we all know, right? Okay. Girls, I don't know, maybe you still have Barbie dolls. I don't know what happens in the girl world, okay? But let's say, for example, okay, someone told you you can do something that you like, but your parents said you've only got 1 hour to do that one thing, okay? Because after that you have to study and you have to do the boring things which you don't like, right? But you only have 1 hour to do that thing. But let's say your parents said to you, if you clean up today, you have the whole day to do the fun things you want to do. Would you clean up?
Yeah.
Yeah, because you have a whole day of playing on the Xbox and no one's going to tell you to switch it off. Yes? Okay. Likewise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to you, in the dunya, okay, you only have a certain amount of time to do the fun things you want to do. Okay? The rest of the time, you have to do the important things like cleaning your soul from evil. Okay? Like cleaning the world from pollution. Okay? Like cleaning the minds of people from bad thoughts. Okay? And ill intent. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you spend a little bit of time in this world cleaning up, then the rest of the life in the hereafter, which never ends, okay, you can do all the fun things that you want to do. Okay? So let me give you an example. Is 40 years a long time or a small time?
Long
time?
Okay.
Small time? 40 years. How old are you now?
10.
So how long will it take you to become 50? Do you think that's a long time before you become 50?
Yeah,
right? Okay. Now, what if I told you there's another way to measure time? You know, like there's always different theories of how you measure time, right? Right now we measure time over speed, distance, and then we get time, right? Okay. But what if there's another way to measure time? What if I told you 40 years is only 1 second? Would that be a long time or not?
No.
No. Okay. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, okay, in the next life, which is in Jannah, one day in paradise is equal to 1,000 years in this world. Okay, one day in paradise is equal to 1,000 years in this world. So if we were to break down and compare, if we were to do that 1,000, okay, of a lifetime here, in comparison to one day in Akhirah, what we turn out with is every 44 years in this life is 1 minute in the next life. So that means if I said to you, spend 1 minute cleaning up and the rest of your life is going to be fun, if I said to you, spend 44 years in this life, which is equal to 1 minute in the next life, being good, then the rest of that life will always be good for you. Okay? Let's talk about that next life. What do we get in that next life? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, لَهُمْ فِيهَا مَا يَشْتَهُونَ. Okay? Whatever you desire in the next life, it comes to you. So you don't even need to, you know, tweet someone to say, I want a biscuit. You don't need to poke them on Facebook or send them an Instagram. You don't need to pick up your phone and call your mother and say, Mom, is dinner ready? Can I bring my friends home? None of that. You just have to think, I want something, and immediately it happens. Okay? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you have the best of clothes. Okay, who likes gold? Girls, do you like gold? Jewelry, bling bling, okay? You like that kind of stuff? Okay. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says you have infinite amount of gold. Okay. For those of us who want like food, there's infinite amount of food. Okay. There's rivers of milk. Okay. You know how your parents try to tell you drink milk before it goes bad? In Jannah, there's rivers flowing of milk. It never finishes. And that milk is mixed with honey. Okay, when we read the Qur'an al-Kareem, that's why we read the Qur'an. Because it tells us what's to come, what's in the next life. Okay. So now if I told you, you can have all of that forever. It never finishes. You never die, you never become sick, and you never become sad. Allah says in Jannah, you never become sad. Okay. No one comes up to you and tells you something bad. There's no bad news in Jannah. It's all good news. Okay. If I told you you can have all of that, and all you had to do is spend 1 minute of that life, the next life, being good, just for 1 minute, that's 60 seconds if you count it in this world. Okay? But 1 minute in that life is 44 years here. So for 44 years, if you can become a good Muslim or a good Muslimah, okay, for 44 years you don't tell lies, you don't cheat people, okay, you don't do haram, anything that Allah said is bad, you don't do, then the next life is all for you. Okay.
And also, I'm sorry.
Yeah, Bismillah.
Dad and mom.
Yes.
They have to listen to mom and dad. That's important.
Very important.
Because Rubaa al-Walidain or Rubaa Allah?
Today we're going to be talking, sorry to cut you off, Amu. Today we're going to be talking about which Imam. Does anybody know which Imam we're celebrating his birth? Yes, yes. Okay, think about it. What do we call ourselves? We are Shia, we are Ithna Ashari, we are Ja'fari, yes? So which Imam is it? We are Ja'fari. Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam. Allah sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Okay, Imam Ja'far alayhi salam, Allah says, Allah made three things joined with three things. Okay, there's three partners in this life. One without the other will never be accepted by Allah. Okay? So whenever you read the Quran, you will always find that salah comes with zakat. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alladhina yuqimuna as-salata wa yu'tuna az-zakat. Always you will find zakat and salah, charity and praying are always connected. If you pray but you don't give charity, Allah says your prayer will not count in the day of Qiyamah. And if you give charity but you don't pray, your charity doesn't count in the Qiyamah. Okay? Then the other one, the Imam says, Amr bil ma'ruf and nahi an al munkar. Both come together. You have to tell people to do good and you have to stop people from doing bad. But telling someone to do good without preventing bad is not good. And telling someone not to do bad without giving them an alternative good is also not good. Okay. Then he says the most important one, right? Ridha Allah wa ridha al-walidain. Listening to Allah and listening to your parents. One without the other doesn't count. Okay. So I can say, I pray, I listen to my parents. So I pray, I go to Hajj, I go to Ziyarah, I help build a masjid, but I don't listen to my mom. Allah says none of that counts. Right? Let me tell you how important it is to listen to your parents. Okay, salallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Okay, so imagine Rasulullah is with us right now, okay? And he said to us, I need money. How many of us would give him money? Imagine Rasulullah said, someone's coming to kill me, I need you to protect me. How many of us will protect him? Okay. Imagine Rasulullah said, I need help. How many of you will help me? We will, all will help him. How many of us will think these things will take us to Jannah? These things will take us to paradise? That Allah will be happy with us if we've done these things? Okay. Let me tell you a story about a man who did all these things, but when he was about to die, he couldn't even say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Every time he wanted to say the Shahada, the angel of death would strangle him. And his face would become dark because all the blood would be drained. Okay? So the people went to Rasulullah, they said, Ya Rasulullah, this man gave money when you needed financial help for the Muslim community. This man helped you build a masjid. This man fought alongside you. This man protected you with his life. And now he's about to die. And if he dies and none of this helps him, no one will ever become a Muslim because they will think, well, none of that worked for anything. You know what Rasulullah said? He said, where's his parents? You see, a doctor, when a doctor sees a person, he automatically knows what's wrong with that person, yes? Because he's a professional. Rasulullah looked at this man and immediately he knew what was wrong. He said, all the things he done for me were good, but there's one thing that was more important than all of these he didn't do. Where's his parents? They said, his father is dead a long time ago, but his mother is alive. He said, okay, then tell his mother to come here very quickly. So his mother came. Rasulullah said, O woman, are you happy with your son? Are you what we call in the Arabic world, Razi, and in the Desi world, we say Razi, right? Are you happy with your son? She said, no, Ya Rasulullah. I am angry with him. Adab. I'm angry with him. Right? Rasulullah said to her, okay, then forgive him. Because if you don't forgive him, Allah will never forgive him. She said, no, Ya Rasulullah, I will never forgive him. He said, why? She said, 6 years, whenever I tell him to do something, he always mumbles and he walks away. He doesn't do anything. Right? And sometimes our mother says, come do something. You're like, mom, I'm playing games. Go do it yourself. Or we come home and we're like, where's my food? Like our mother is a servant, right? So this is what the guy used to do to his mother. He used to treat her badly. So Rasulullah said, are you not going to forgive him? She said, no. You know what Rasulullah said? He looked to his two companions, Salman and Ammar. He said, Salman, Ammar, go cut down trees and bring me the wood. They said, why? He said, I'm going to burn him. The woman said, no, Rasulullah, what do you mean you're going to burn him? That's my son. He said, you don't want him to burn in the dunya, but you want him to burn in hell for the rest of his life? She said, no, I don't want him to burn in hell. He said, if you don't forgive him, he will never smell Jannah. As soon as he dies, Malik al-Maut will not even ask him about Salah. He will not ask him about fasting. He will not ask him about Quran. He will not ask him about anything. He'll say, this person, he made his mother angry. Put him in hell immediately. No, they won't even open your book. If you're known as a person that angers your parents, immediately you go to hell. Right? So it's very important. Ridha Allah, ridha al-walidain. And then the Imam alayhi salamullah reads the ayah of the Quran, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And indeed, Allah has commanded us to worship no other God except Him and be good to our parents. The Imam talks about this ayah. He says, look how beautiful Allah is. Allah says He made a command, you worship no one but Him. And immediately He said your parents. He didn't say Salah, He didn't say Zakat, He didn't say Hajj, He didn't say become a follower of Rasulullah, He didn't say become a follower of Imam Ali. He said all these are important, yes. But if you don't respect your parents, none of these things will ever matter, right? I'll give you the best example. Can you go to university if you haven't finished elementary school?
No.
Can you go to university if you haven't finished high school?
No.
No. So I can go to university and say, I know the theory of Einstein, but I didn't do elementary school and high school. What do they say to you?
Get out.
Get out, right? You say, but I know, I done other things which gave me knowledge. They say, yeah, but there's a requirement. The requirement is, you have to show me your GDPs, right? You have to show me, or is it GDAs over here? GPA, right? You have to show me those scores, otherwise I can't let you in school, it's a system. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of Qiyamah, you come and you say, okay boss, I want to go to Jannah. He says, no. You say, yeah, but I prayed. He says, yeah, but you didn't do your elementary requirements. What was my elementary requirements? Be good to your parents. You don't have the basics. Okay? So it's very important that we have to be good to our parents. Do you know how important it is to be good to our parents?
Yeah.
Very important. There's a man who traveled 6 weeks from Yemen to come to Medina. And he came to Rasulullah, and this person wasn't even a Muslim, okay? He came to Rasulullah and he said, Ya Rasulullah, I have such a big problem in my life that I don't think Allah will ever resolve it. So I heard that there is a prophet who Allah responds to his prayers. So I journeyed all this way so that you can pray for me. You know what Rasulullah said to him? I wish you wouldn't have wasted your time. He said, what do you mean? Do you mean your dua is not accepted, your prayer is not accepted? He said, no, my prayer is accepted. But there's another person whose prayers is faster than mine. He said, is there another prophet? He said, no, it's not a prophet. It's your mother. The mother's dua is answered quicker than the dua of a prophet for his community. You know what the guy said to Rasulullah? He said, Ya Rasulullah, my mother is dead. You know what Rasulullah said to him? So what? Go to her grave and ask her to pray for you. Because a mother's heart is never disconnected from its child. Allah says, I have 99 different levels of mercy. The only one that I will show you in this life is your mother. That's the only mercy you will ever see from me. What's the word for mercy? Rahmah. Right? Right? What's the word for the mother's womb? Rahim. Even Allah, when He says, I am Rahman and Rahim, He used the word, the womb of the mother, to describe His mercy. Because in the womb of our mother, we've done nothing good, right? We haven't even come to the world. But our mother gives us food from her food. Our mother gives us warmth. She protects us from the cold, right? Our mother protects us from the harsh elements of the world in her womb, yes? Allah says, if you want to know my mercy, think about your mother's womb. Even when you do bad things in the world, I still protect you and provide for you, just like your mother's womb protected and provided for you. So the first mercy of Allah and the only mercy of Allah that we see in the dunya is the womb of our mother. And that's why in Salah, what do we say? رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا وَزِدْهُمْ بِالْحِسْنِ إِحْسَانًا وَزِدْهُمْ بِالسَّيِّئَاتِ عَفْوًا وَغُفْرَانًا. We pray for our parents always. What do we pray? Oh Allah, have mercy on my parents in the same way that they had mercy on me when I was a kid. Right? And if they have done good, increase their good. And if they ever did wrong, don't punish them. Substitute their wrong for my good deeds. Give me their bad deeds and give them my good deeds. Right? Because sometimes your parents wanted to eat food, but they said you're hungry, so they gave you their food and they stayed hungry, yes? Sometimes your parents wanted to buy new clothes for themselves, but you told them that there's a school party or something, so you need a new outfit, or there's a wedding coming up. That's why sometimes you see your mother and father wearing the same clothes to every wedding, but you always have new clothes for every different wedding, yes? Right? Because they gave you their good and they kept your bad. So we say, Allah, on the day of Qiyamah, take my good deeds and give them to my parents. And take their bad deeds and give them to me. I want to be the person who's wearing the same clothes in Qiyamah, but let them have all the new clothes. Okay? So it's very, very, very important for us to come to madrasa. Okay? It's very important for us to do the homework in madrasa here that we do in the same way that we do over there, okay? Because in that school, our reward will be given in this life. But in this school, our reward will be given in this life as well as in the next life, okay? And in this school, we learn the things that they don't teach us in the other school. Do they teach you about your parents in the other school, how to love them?
No.
As a matter of fact, in the other schools, they tell you if your parents have, you know, told you off, call the police, right? We'll put you in social care and we'll take care of you, right? So in the other school, they don't care about your parents. Whereas in this school, we care about your parents. In the other school, they don't tell you about your neighbors. In this school, we teach you about your neighbors, right? Be kind to your neighbors. So it's very, very important that we come to the school, we keep coming to the school. And when we graduate from the school, it's very important that we come back to teach the new classes we come to the school, okay? So that then, you know, the teachers here, they can also go and do the other things that they've put on hold in life. And then you come back and you teach, and then you also get the thawab, okay? So two things I want to ask you. One is to give salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Second thing is to go and hug your parents if they are here. If they're not here, go and hug your teachers because they have the same respect as your parents. Chop, chop, let's go. It's your teachers. Go hug your teachers. Tell them thank you.
All right, wadu time. Wadu time, everybody. Let's go.
So uncle's gonna lead the salah because I'm praying the pastor. So he'll be leading the salah. I'm just gonna pray.
He's downstairs, he's gone.
I do. هيدا
do the adhan. Do the adhan, you want.
Both of you, Adam. Yeah, you and Haida. And Muhammad, all of you. Yeah. Yalla.
Now. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد الله اكبر
Yeah, we're straight.
Now,
it's good.
Is that good?
Yeah.
Is that good? Yeah.
Allahumma shukran.